Good morning, students. Today we will start with the PV. So what is a solar energy? Now the solar energy is typically a photovoltaic cell or a solar cell which is made up of a semiconductor device which converts sunlight directly into a direct current or electricity. Now the conversion of photovoltaic cells, how it is made up of conversion of the solar energy into electrical energy. Now the typical construction, when you look into the construction, it is made up of a small n type of semiconductor, small layer of an n type of semiconductor, and which is sandwiched with the large p type of semiconductor, and at the top and the metallic grids are placed. And the metallic grids is coated with a layer of an anti-reflective layer, a polymer which is made up of an anti-reflective layer, acting as an anti-reflective layer. And at the bottom, it is coated with a thin wafer of aluminium or platinum. And the top metallic grid act as a top contact. And at the bottom, the thin layer wafer of aluminium or platinum is acting as a bottom contact, and which is connected for a application. Now the construction, when you look into the construction, a typical silicon photovoltaic cell is composed of a thin polycrystalline silicon wafer consisting of an ultra thin layer of phosphorus doped, that is what is called as n type of semiconductor, sandwiched with the small n type of semiconductor. Small portion of n type of semiconductor is sandwiched with a large portion of a p type of a semiconductors to form a p-n junction. Now once the p-n junction forms, on the top of the p-n junction, a metallic grid is placed for electrical contact and coated with the anti-reflective layer. So in between the two metallic grids, which will act as a harvester for the sunlight, so it will act as a the sunlight to fall on the photovoltaic cell perpendicularly. So the metallic grid is coated with an anti-reflective layer over the top, in between the grid lines. The grid lines will be allows the direct fall of the sunlight to the semiconductor surface. And the cell on the back side of the cell is coated with a wrapper of aluminium or platinum, which is acting as a bottom contact. Now, this looks like this. The solar radiation, which consists of photons of a particular energy, so that energy is called as photonic energies. Now, the negative electrons will be generated onto the n type of semiconductors. In between, you sandwich it with the positive holes, and the bottom contact will be made up of either platinum wrapper, and the top contact is the metallic grid, and it is connected to an external source of current. Now, what happens during the now when you look into the working, in light of suitable radiation or a frequency falls on an p-n junction diode, electron hole pairs are generated. So electron hole pairs are generated in the n type as well as p type of a semiconductor. N type generates an electron and p type generates a holes generated by the absorption of radiation. So this absorption of radiation takes place, the absorption of radiation of a suitable frequency. So energy of the absorption is more than the barrier potential of the p-n junction. So the condition applied is only those photons which has an energy which is more than the barrier potential of p-n junction will get absorbed into the p-n junction diode. And when the suitable radiation of a certain frequency which has a more energy than the barrier potential of the p-n junction, when it gets absorbed inside the body of the semiconductor, electron hole pairs are generated. Electron hole pairs are polarized, and electron will start moving towards the top contact, and holes are start moving towards the bottom contact. When these two ends are electrically connected, top contact through the metallic grid and the bottom contact through the aluminium or the platinum wafer through the conductor, so there is a flow of current between the two ends and through the external circuits. So thus the photoelectric current is generated and it will be used for external applications. Now the fundamental equation which is governing the ejection of the or absorption of the photons is the E is equal to h nu. So this E is the energy of the photons which is get absorbed into the body of the semiconductor. So this energy should be energy barrier energy of the this energy should be greater than the barrier energy of the photovoltaic cells, that E is equal to h nu, that is equal to hc by lambda. Now where the h is the Planck's constant, nu is the frequency of photons, and lambda is the wavelength of the. Now what are the advantages of PV cells? Now when you look into the advantages of PV cells, the first one is it is using in solar energy which consists of photons. So solar energy is an unlimited and renewable source, and the PV cells do not require charging and discharging and produce electrical energy as long as the sunlight is available. So there is no charging and discharging is not required. There is no moving parts in the PV cells, only the small n-type of the semiconductor sandwiched with the p-type of the semiconductor. There is no moving parts, hence there is no problem of wear and tear. And PV cells generate electrical energy at ambient temperature. So the temperature of the generation of the electricity will be carried out at a very optimum temperature. And the next advantage is that raw material silicon is abundantly available in the earth crust. So raw material for the generation of PV cells is abundantly available, and they can be conveniently used for all domestic and electrical appliances. And very important is the advantage is that these PV cells do not corrode. So it does not undergo any corrosion. It does not have any anode or a cathode, and it is quite economical. Now the disadvantages of PV cells is it can able to generate electricity only in presence of sunlight. So they are not available to produce electricity during night time. So it works only in the daytime, and very expensive installation, and expensive silicon, pure silicon is very expensive, and the installation is very very costly. And the PV cells generate only direct current. So the only you can obtain direct current, not alternative current can be obtained. So unavailable during monsoon, that is what is called as disadvantage is that it varies with the latitude and climatic conditions, and the presence of dust or the moisture present in the atmosphere. So this is the another disadvantages of a PV cells. Now the continuation of the PV cells, the production of solar cell grade silicon by union carbide process, and this production of solar cell grade silicon, the first it involves five steps. So we will study one by one steps. The production of first one is the metallurgical grade silicon. So that is what is called as a carbothermic reduction of silicon. Now the carbothermic reduction of the silicon takes place. So silicon oxide is a sand. Sand is the mixed with appropriate amount of coke. So usually the one portion of the sand is mixed with five portions of and the coke. Coke is mixed with the sand in a large porcelain crucible. And this porcelain crucible is placed with two platinum electrodes, and this platinum electrode, very high electric discharges, platinum electrodes are connected with each other to produce very high electric discharge. Now during this discharge process, coke combines with silicon oxide and reduces the silicon oxide to an molten silicon. So this silicon, molten silicon, is getting precipitated after the combination of coke with the silicon oxide, and liberates the carbon monoxide gas, and this carbon monoxide is subsequently converted to carbon dioxide, and it escapes from the porcelain crucible. Now this molten silicon is composed of four different types of impurities, the majorly. So second step is the refining of the silicon. So the refining includes the four major impurities. The first impurity is aluminium, And second impurity is calcium, and third impurity is magnesium. So these impurities are removed by passing oxygen gas or bubbling oxygen inside the molten silicon. So the aluminium, if at all present, reacts with the silicon. When you bubble with an oxygen, it will again convert into silicon dioxide. Now the silicon oxide will react with the aluminium and converts into an free silicon and aluminium oxide. Calcium reacts with the 2 moles of calcium reacts with SiO2, give rise to silicon plus 2 moles of calcium oxide. And magnesium reacts with silicon oxide, give rise to free silicon plus 2 moles of magnesium oxide. So the free silicon is liberated, and the corresponding impurities like aluminium, calcium and magnesium are converted into aluminium oxide, calcium oxide as well as magnesium oxide. Now these impurities are removed as in the form of corresponding silicates. Now for example, aluminium is removed in the form of an aluminium silicate, so Al2SiO3, and calcium is removed in the form of a calcium silicate. Now you know that magnesium is removed as magnesium silicate. Now all these silicates are lighter in weight and it floats on the surface of the molten silicon and can be easily removed. So thus, by refining of removing aluminium, calcium and magnesium from the molten silicon, you will get the metallurgical grade silicon. That is the second step of the production. And in the third step of the production, this is actually the union carbide process. The molten silicon is subjected with passing with dry HCl gas. Now the molten silicon, when it passes with the dry HCl gas, the first it forms a very important compound, that is what is called as silicon reacts with 3 moles of HCl, giving rise to a trichlorosilane. Now this trichlorosilane it will form, and a little portion of the silicon also converts into a tetrachlorosilane. So you get two compounds here. One is the trichlorosilane as well as tetrachlorosilane. So the small portion of tetrachlorosilane is taken out, SiCl4. You can see the reaction very clearly. Silicon reacts with 3HCl. Now it forms a trichlorosilane, and silicon again reacts with 4 moles of HCl. These are the two types of two different reactions which takes place in this process, and it forms a small amount of tetrachlorosilane. Now this tetrachlorosilane is hydrogenated. A tetrachlorosilane forms along with the trichlorosilane, is taken out, and tetrachlorosilane is hydrogenated, converted back into a trichlorosilane, and it is mixed with the earlier crop. So in the third step, production of semiconductor grade silicon, the molten silicon or metallurgical grade silicon obtained in the second step is passed with the dye HCl gas to form trichlorosilane and little amount of tetrachlorosilane. This tetrachlorosilane is hydrogenated and converted at 1000 degrees Celsius in presence of an hydrogenating catalyst like nickel or platinum, and converted into a trichlorosilane and an HCl. Fourth step is trichlorosilane is converted into silane by passing through a fixed bed columns of quaternary ammonium ion exchange resin as a catalyst. Now how does this reaction takes place? Now the trichlorosilane is further converted into a dichlorosilane and then tetrachlorosilane. So the trichlorosilane, 2 moles of HSiCl3 in presence of catalyst like in quaternary ammonium ion exchange resin, and when it is passed through vapors of trichlorosilane is passed through the catalyst quaternary ammonium ion exchange resin, is converted into a dichlorosilane and then tetrachlorosilane. Now this tetrachlorosilane is again back hydrogenated, taken to the third step, converted back into a trichlorosilane and recycled. Now the dichlorosilane H2SiCl2, so in a dichlorosilane is subsequently converted into a silane SiH4 and then trichlorosilane. So the obtained trichlorosilane again is taken to this fourth step and converted into again dichloroxylene. It's a cycle of the process where the trichloroxylene is converted into dichloroxylene and dichloroxylene is converted into xylene as well as a trichloroxylene. So the trichloroxylene forms here in the fourth step is converted, taken to the next step, taken to the previous step and converted into dichloroxylene. So the both the xylene and the trichloroxylene, xylene is distilled. The pure xylene is taken out in this step and subjected for pyrolysis. Pyrolysis is the cracking process where the hydrogen present in the xylene is being removed in the form of a hydrogen gas. Now the SiH4 is subjected for pyrolysis, so at around 800 to 1000 degrees Celsius. So pure silicon is obtained with the 2 moles of hydrogen gas is removed from the xylene. So the xylene liquid is subjected for pyrolysis at 800 to 1000 degrees Celsius in presence of catalyst, and pure silicon is getting precipitated and with the removal of 2 moles of hydrogen gas. And this silicon is around 99.98% pure, that is what is called as a solar cell grade silicon. Thank you.